thank you very much for talking to the History of Football. Just to start with the sort of the early days, Maradona and Di Stefano and Pele and all the great players that we've spoken to, they've all talked about how they started playing football, and certainly for the South Americans, mm-hmm. they all started playing on the street, and that's where they learned their trade. Where did you start playing football?
Well, basically the same, the streets of Belfast. You know, I think you find that most, there's not many players come from very wealthy backgrounds, if any. And basically all the great players started off the same. You know, we all had dreams, kicking a ball around the streets with all our pals. And it was a way of escaping from, you know, from the poverty, really. And it's no different in Belfast, you know. Everyone struggled a little bit, and there was one or two ways of getting out. One was boxing, I suppose, which was the same all over the world, or football, which was the big thing, and it was what everyone dreamed about. Everybody kicked the ball around, and you just hoped it was a way of escaping. So I was no different than the other kids, kicking the ball around, you know, on the way to school, on the way back from school, the top of the street, you know, bottom of the street, anywhere.
Talking about Belfast Celtic, I mean, throughout the 30s and 40s, they were a great side that people think that had they been around later on when European competition started, then they could have been a team that were known worldwide. I mean, who Belfast Celtic, I think, stopped in 47, I think. Yeah, 47 or 48. I mean, who were the teams that you were looking up to as a child in Northern Ireland?
Well, Northern Ireland, I supported Glentoran purely and simply the fact that my grandfather lived almost on the pitch. He was about, you know, 50 yards away from the main entrance, so he used to take me to watch. They were my team. And then, of course, when television came in, most people had a team in England they supported. My team were Wolves. Because at the time TV had come in and the floodlights, and Europe was becoming really, you know, it was the start of Europe becoming massive, and Wolves were one of the first clubs. Yeah, you know, they used to get the Russians coming over and playing them, and to us kids, like the Russians, it was like they were like aliens. I mean, the Russians were, it was a different world, and so I used to keep a scrapbook as a kid. And Glentoran were my Belfast team, and Wolves were the team I supported in England.
Right. Why Wolves?
Because they were the best. They were the best around at the time. They had some great players, and a lot of internationals in the squad. But the imagination was, you know, it started to become theatre, and they were the best team around at the time, playing against foreign opposition, which hadn't happened before.
Do you think that in Northern Ireland, the demise of Belfast Celtic affected the league there?
I think when Belfast Celtic finished, yeah. But the difference was, of course, that they were getting big crowds, and, you know, people were turning up. And I mean, now no one watches Irish league football. It's a shame, you know. Even international games now, it's difficult to get a big crowd in. And hopefully it'll change. You know, I believe that, you know, as they're saying, the ball's round to go around, and hopefully it'll come back. But in those days, of course, Belfast Celtic, and they still talk about them, the older generation, they were the only team really that were around in Ireland at the time.
And how much has football been affected by the sectarian divides that affect everything else over there?
Well, unfortunately, I think you find with football, and not only in Northern Ireland, but even more so in other countries, you know, Iraq and Iran, when they play, it's like warfare when they play football. And unfortunately, it's part and parcel of football. And funny enough, not in other sports for some strange reason, or not as much in other sports. I mean, when you think of Northern Ireland, they've got an All-Ireland rugby team and hockey and stuff like that. And but football's always been, you know, it's always been that religious divide all over the world, unfortunately, which is a shame, because sports shouldn't be like that. But that's just the way the climate is, and again, hopefully that will change in Northern Ireland.
I suppose because they are so popular in these countries. In Iran, it's unbelievable that the only other thing that is as popular as their religion is football. So
yeah.
Therefore, people are going to try and manipulate that.
Well, it's as close as they get to religion, football, in a lot of the countries, you know. what we would call third world countries, so to speak. It really is a religion, and it's only second to it. And sometimes there's not much difference between the two, and that's why there's, you know, you see so many riots in foreign countries. We have crowd trouble, but nothing like they do in some countries. It's frightening.
Mm-hmm. One of the thousands of things that I've read about you is that you considered joining the priesthood as a child. Is that true?
No. No, never. No, my grandfather wasn't deeply religious, made sure we went to church and Sunday school and all that sort of stuff. No, it wouldn't have been for me, I don't think.
Yeah, I couldn't really see that suiting you, but you arrived in Man United in 61 as a teenager.
Yeah.
Very young, and you know, a very popular story is how you actually ran away. That's the first thing you did. What happened there?
Well, I'd gone over with another young lad called Eric McMorty, and we'd both, neither of us, I'd be honest, out of Belfast before. So to go to Cross Water, as we called it, it was like a big adventure, but a frightening adventure, because I'd never been outside of Belfast basically before, and he hadn't either. So to go and, you know, have to get on a boat and then a train and then a taxi and head for Old Trafford, it was a bit daunting, to say the least. And we were a couple of skinny little kids, never been away from home, and we didn't fancy it. And I think if we hadn't been together, we might not have come back, but we'd sort of talked each other into it. And but luckily, you know, everyone knows I went back. Eric didn't for quite a while. He stayed in Ireland and played Irish League football for a while. Then ended up going to Middlesbrough, and we ended up becoming good friends at the end of it, because we both played for Northern Ireland eventually. But It was just a frightening experience for a couple of skinny little kids who had never been away from home before.
Yeah, how old were you then?
15. I went straight from school, same as Eric. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the only football we played was, you know, school football, and I played for the local boys' club, and Eric played for his local boys' club. So it was a bit different going to Manchester United.
Yeah.
And kicking a ball around for Craigie Boys' Club.
You arrived, of course, in the wake of the Munich air crash. What was the atmosphere at the club like at that time?
Well, it was weird because, you know, everyone obviously knew about it. You know, they lost a great side, and anyone interested in football, of course, you know, remembered it. And it was only 3 years later that I was joining the club, and they were rebuilding. It was sort of taboo. No one talked about it. I mean, it was very rarely brought up. It was only in later years that people were able to talk about it. So it'll be part of the rebuilding as well. And to think within 10 years of the terrible crash that had taken almost a whole team in pursuit of European glory, that we were the first English side to win it. So it was in the space of 10 years, which was amazing. And just to be part of that, new kids coming through, and of course, a few of the survivors, Bobby and Bill Foulkes and Harry Gregg, and Harry, of course, being Irish, was a big hero to everybody in Ireland. He was a hero even before the crash, but, you know, what he did when the crash happened, it was, you know, became folklore in Northern Ireland.
Mm. Sure. And, I mean, how much of that success was down to Matt Busby?
Well, it's amazing when you think that the boss almost lost his life. And and they talk about second in command. Jimmy Murphy, who was his second in command, he held it all together, really, you know. And the boss went through a terrible time almost. I mean, he had the last rites about three times or something like that. But, you know, he just had that strength. He wanted to fight on and carry on, and he did. And he was the reason. He was the main reason. He had a lot of backup. A lot of people worked very hard when he couldn't. But when it came to it, he was the one that got it all together and brought in players very quickly to fill certain positions. You know, he basically looked at what he needed and went out and got it. He signed Dennis, he signed Paddy Creer, and, you know, people like that. And of course, he had Bobby, who was world class. And they had a lot of young kids coming through as well. So then it was a nice blend. Brian Kidd came through, played in the final when he was 19. So We had a good side, but didn't last long enough. But he was the main man. He was amazing, different class, and My father, you know, you can't say a bad word about Sir Matt in our family. He was a genius, really, at what he did.
Why was that? Was he in the Alex Ferguson kind of mold of manager? Sort of
no, Alex Ferguson was in his mold. It was, I think if there's such a thing as a godfather, Sir Matt was it. But there were and it was nice as well because there were so many great managers around. You know, Bill Shankly was around, he was a friend of Sir Matt's. Jock Steen was around, who was also a close friend, and people like that. Don Revie came in at Leeds and did a terrific job, and there were so many great managers around. And it's amazing, Ethan, now they talk about Fergie, of course, and they were all sort of basically from the same mould. You know, they know the game inside out. They'd all played at a high level, and they could manage men and manage them differently as well as a group, you know, and to find that it's a bit of an art to be able to handle 30, 40 professional athletes all at the same time and get something out of them.
Yeah. I don't know, more so now maybe, I don't know, with the amount of money. I know that Julia was talking about that. Just how difficult it is to be managing not only 30 professional sportsmen, but now 30 millionaires.
Yeah, I mean, it's become, you're talking now, it's massive money. I mean, it was cloth cap when I started. It's now corporate. I mean, that's the big difference, the money side of it. But again, you still have to get the results and be able to handle people, whether they're earning £100 a week or £100,000 a week. You've still got to be able to keep it all together and keep them playing. And of course, even more so as well because of the number of players you have in a squad, in successful squads. Because I think the couple of years we won the title in 65 and 67, we only used about 18 players through the whole season. And we used to play 42 games in the league as opposed to 38, plus the cup games and internationals. So it's a little bit difficult to keep everybody happy. And it's even more difficult these days because you have more and massive money. It's can be frightening at times. And I think sometimes, maybe today, players aren't too bothered about whether they play or not. They're still getting their money, whether they're sitting on the bench or playing. We had to play to get to earn our money. That was the difference.
Oh, you didn't get a... You weren't like...
Well, you didn't get your bonuses. You got your basic wages. But we were on all sorts of bonuses, crowd bonus and win bonus and stuff like that, so...
In the early 60s, that there was the they abolished the maximum wage, didn't they? I mean, how did that affect you on a day-to-day basis?
Funnily enough, it didn't really affect me that much, the maximum wage, because most of my money was outside of football. I played because I loved it. I mean, I don't even know how much I was earning in those days, and because I was doing so much outside of the game. It was the big money, as it is today. Yeah, that's never changed. I mean, I was probably taking home maybe £1,000 a week when I was 17. And so when you work that out, that's a lot of money. It's a lot of money today to a lot of people. And I was doing that when I was 17.
And so even at the age of 17, you'd already started earning money outside with all the advertising and the
Well, pretty quickly afterwards, yeah. It was, what was it, about 1920, but I mean, it was. But I played because I loved it. I mean, it was always nice to be able to go out and buy a car for cash and stuff like that, which is what we did, you know, because we were on good money, and it was a nice way of earning a living, getting paid for something you dreamt about, and the fact that all your pals from school and back home in Ireland were. Repent to watch you do something they dreamt about. It was a little bit of a bonus, to say the least.
Yeah, I always wonder whether the reality would be different to the, you know, you talk about other people dreaming about it, but when you actually start doing it, of course, it becomes a reality, so it's...
It really is. It's just a dream. I mean, we all had it as kids growing up. All my pals wanted to be footballers, and none of them ever made it, except me. And you know, but that's, and the same when I went to United Lads, I saw thousands of kids come and go, and some arrived who were maybe better at my age than I was, but you know, it doesn't always work out that way, you know. And hundreds and hundreds were sent home, you know, disappointed, and had to go back and work in the shipyards or wherever they ended up.
Yeah, yeah, it's tough, isn't it? In the 63 FA Cup, I don't think you played against Leicester.
No.
And Man United won that, and that was their first their first cup since the crash. How come you didn't play? Is that because I hadn't signed.
I was there and went to the final, and my dad went to find out if I was going to sign, because that May was my 17th birthday, and that's when I signed professional, that month they won it.
Okay.
But I actually went to the game and watched it with the rest of the staff, and a few months later I was in the team, so it was an even bigger dream.
And so from their first trophy, I mean, it all started for Man United from their own in the 60s. 1964, in the European Cup Winners' Cup against Lisbon, Sporting Lisbon. And you won the first leg 4-1. And then in the second leg, Man United lost 5-0.
Mm.
Was that quite a learning curve in European football?
It was, yeah. It certainly taught you the ups and downs very quickly. and hopefully we learned from it. We didn't get slaughtered too many times after that. It's, I think we went out expecting just to turn up, but that's not the reality of football. So we learned a very sharp lesson very quickly. And after that, it was amazing. The next few years, some of the away results we got were absolutely amazing after that, because I think we decided, not only the manager but the players, it certainly wasn't going to happen again to throw away a 3-goal lead. And when you're a good side, it's just not it's not done.
Well, I mean, what happened in that particular game?
Well, I think we just went out and sort of thought it was all over. Basically, we thought we just had to turn up. Of course, they got an early goal, put them back in it. And we just went to pieces. Which can happen. Didn't happen to us very often, but it did that time.
I guess early on. Domestically, at the time in England, what was the rivalry like between Man United and Man City?
Well, the great thing about the 60s were that it wasn't only Man City and Man United, because City had a great side as well, full of internationals. And that's why so many teams won the league in the 60s and early 70s, because there wasn't much difference between them. You know, you had Liverpool and Everton who won the title, you had Arsenal who won the title, Leeds won the title, Man City won the title, we won the title. I mean, there were always, you know, 10 sides in there with a chance, and which is why it was even more difficult. But City had a great side, and it was good for Manchester as well. I've always said that. I love to see City doing well, because they've got a tremendous support, and they're supposed to be the poor neighbours.
Mm.
But even when they're struggling, they're getting 30,000-odd, which is a draw of football, especially in places like Manchester and Liverpool.
Mm. Does Manchester have its own unique football culture?
Yeah, I think even more so in those days, because so many local boys played for both sides. You know, there was always, you know, 3, 4, 5 boys who'd been brought up in Manchester, and you were either one or the other, you know, there was no in between. So the rivalry was even more fierce. In later years, of course, not so many local lads who were brought up in Manchester. You know, they were coming from all over the country, but in those days it was half Manchester against the other half, and that was it. And it just added that little bit of extra, not that it needed it in derby matches in those days.
And what about Leeds?
Well, I think it moved over a bit, because when you're nodding, you're moving the camera a bit.
Oh, right, away.
That's it.
Yeah, Leeds were very hard, a very hard side. Were they seen as sort of the ugly side of football?
Oh, they were in the game, yeah, definitely. Against fellow pros, I mean, if you ask anyone that played from those days, who the hardest team, the most physical, there was no doubt about it. And they were up to all the little tricks, and played for a time when they had to, and just little things they used to do and get away with. And then a few, I don't mind people being hard, but they had a few nasty players as well who didn't mind hurting you. And I think almost to a man, if you ask most players who played in that time, there'll be one Leeds player that'll come up more often than not when it comes to, as we call, going over the top.
Yeah, well, that brings me on quite nicely to Estudiantes de La Plata, the Argentine side. Now, having lost the away leg in Buenos Aires, which must have been an incredible experience. I've been out in Argentina a few times, and I've been. It's dying a bit, I think, the league out there at the moment. But you know, if you still go to the Clásico, the Boca Juniors, River Plate, you know, it's extraordinary. What was your reception like in Buenos Aires that first day?
Well, in those days, going to Argentina was frightening, to say the least. The year before we went, Celtic had been there and got involved in a riot on the pitch, apart from what was going on off it. I mean, we talked earlier about religion. I mean, Argentina is just, I mean, they lose and they throw themselves off the roof. I mean, that's how seriously they take it. You know, they've had people killed for scoring own goals in South America. It was frightening, yeah. And we went there, and they weren't interested in playing. I mean, they were kicking lumps out of you. And the same at Old Trafford. We thought it might be a little bit easier, that they wouldn't do it away from home. They did exactly the same. I ended up getting sent off in the second leg at Old Trafford. And then, of course, because of that, they started playing on neutral grounds, because sooner or later somebody was going to get killed on the pitch. There was no doubt about it.
Were they that bad? Because I mean, I've spoken to all of the Estudiantes players, and they're like, no, that's bollocks. That's all just part of the folklore. And
they were bad. I mean, we come back and we complained, and they'd seen it themselves the year before against Celtic, and we were warned that's what it was going to be like, and even we thought it can't be that bad, and it was. And then the press themselves had said, you know, it's not that bad. But they saw it, and then they said, well, it won't be as, they said themselves that it wouldn't be as bad at home, and it was. You just got to watch the footage. I mean, they weren't interested in the ball. I mean, if you want, we say, you know, you can go past a man or the ball can go past him up, but not both at the same time. That's the way that's the way they worked it out. They were bad, and that's, which is why they changed it. That's why they went to Japan and played, because the authorities were frightened of what was going to happen. Mm. And it was going to get worse. It wasn't going to get better, that's for sure.
Well, the following year, in fact, they played against Inter Milan, and three of their players ended up in prison. Three of the Estudiantes went to prison for 30 days.
See, people have short memories when they say that they weren't that bad. They were. The people who were saying that weren't on the pitch, getting lumps kicked out of them. And people like Bobby Charlton are getting bad injuries. You know, there's something seriously wrong.
Well, we do actually have some footage. The best footage, unfortunately, the footage from South America is such poor quality, and it's been edited by the Argentines, yeah. So it's difficult to see exactly what's going on. The Old Trafford, the footage is actually very good, and there's, you see you getting, as you say, lumps kicked out of you a couple of times. And then there's an incident where there's an Argentine rolling around on the floor. It's you, Bobby Charlton, and you punch somebody in the face, one of the Argentines in the face.
Well, he's getting booked, yeah.
Yeah. What was going on there?
Well, it was easier if he's standing still. So he was being booked for kicking me for the 100th time, so I just said, I'd had enough. And I didn't even wait. I just hit him and walked off. I think I already decided in Argentina that it was going to carry on. There wasn't much point in trying to play football because they weren't going to let you.
You sound exactly the same as we spoke to Jimmy Johnson, the Celtic player. Yeah, you sound exactly the same. After a while, they just snap. But that was, of course, their plan, that to get a player like you, the best player, and then
That's it.
Getting sent off.
Yeah. Stop them playing, and if you can get them sent off, it's a bonus. And they were good at it.
I wonder. I mean, how that affected the image of Argentine football? Because from that day onwards, there's been obviously there was the Falklands War, but from that day onwards, there's been this great conception about the Argentines playing dirty football?
Well, unfortunately, it sticks. You know, that's the way it is in sport. You know, you get a tag and it'll stick with you for a long, long time. But unfortunately, you know, when you see the type of players that they produce since then, you know, class players, you know, particularly our dealers and players like that who've come along, it's brilliant that they've come along. And South American football was had a reputation. Now they've had so many great players. And hopefully started off with Pelé and then Maradona came along. And so South American football, the image has certainly changed, that's for sure. They still know how to get stuck in. It's like the Italians. They're never going to be pussycats. They're always going to hit you and tackle you. But at the same time, there's so much skill there. It just seemed a shame that they had to resort to that too much.
Yeah, of course, it annoys the Argentinians because in Argentina, Estudiantes, they won the league once. That was it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any time, and then they've sort of tarnished the image of football here in Scotland, in Italy, and that spread out. But, moving on to did you see Garrincha play?
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, you didn't mention him among the players.
Well, you can mention the whole Brazilian team when Garrincha played. I mean, even the ones who weren't considered regulars, Didi and Vava and players like that, and Carlos Alberto, and you know, they were amazing players. But Garrincha was special when you think the shape he was, he should have been playing football. But he was amazing, yeah. I mean, but Brazil, they were from a different planet in those days. You know, you had the jewel in the crown, who was Pelé, of course. And you know, see, you don't win the World Cup four times unless you're a little bit special. Mm-hmm. But you see, they played the way it should be played, you know, off the cuff and... You know, the old samba, and you know, it's they love it. I mean, it's and they've shown that you don't have to kick people to win tournaments and be the world champions four times.
Yeah, and is that still possible to play that kind of football today?
Yeah, the French have showed that as well recently. Yeah, I think at the end of the day, skill will always come out on top. You can't kick yourself to trophies. That's not the way to win it. You've got to do it with skill at the end of the day. Fortunately for football, if you're a football fan, skill will always come out on top.
Yeah. The 1968 beat Real Madrid in the semi-finals in the European Cup, 3-3 in the Bernabeu. What were Madrid like at that time? Of course, they'd had that fantastic team of the 50s.
Well, Real Madrid were another one-off. I mean, they were so special. They had my favourite player, Juan Di Stefano, who's the best player I've ever seen. And funny enough, I just found out recently he was Dennis Law's favourite player. And Dennis and I have been teammates and good friends when we finished playing. And I never knew until a couple of years ago. But same thing, you could almost go through their team and name it. I mean, they were brilliant, absolutely brilliant. And they were, again, played so off the cuff. And, well, when the European Cup started, they virtually owned it. I mean, you couldn't get it off them. They won it, I don't know, 5 or 6 years, I think, in a row. But they were getting towards the end a little bit, you know, the same as we did after 68. You know, a lot of players at the same time were getting towards the end. To go there, it was still hard to beat them. And we had only taken, I suppose, to go and play Sporting a couple of years earlier with a 4-1 lead. We went there with just a one goal. And we were 3-1 down at half time and looked like we were on the way out. But it was the boss, he said, you know, when you look at it, we're still only one behind from the first goal. We get another one, we're in with a chance. And we just kept pegging away and did it in the end. And for the last 15, 20 minutes, we just knocked the ball about. We knew we were going to the final then, when we made it 3-3, and their heads dropped, obviously, because it looked like they were just going to carry on from 3-1 and give us another good walloping, but it didn't work out that way.
I was going to say that after the great performance in the Bernabeu, the 3-3, was the final against Benfica then almost a step down? Or?
Well, I think we thought it was going to be easier than it was. It ended up being easy because of the three that we got in extra time, but the actual 90 minutes, we could have lost it. You know, we took the lead, and when they equalised, they had a great chance through Eusebio, who was another great player. And most of the time he managed to tuck it away, but it wasn't to be. And after that, of course, we just, it was like waving a magic wand, you know. Brian Kidd scored, I got the first one. Kiddo scored on his birthday, which was a dream for him. And Bobby got his second, and you know, it also scored with his head, which is unusual. So it was just, you couldn't have written a better script in the end, but it could have gone the other way. You know, I think we felt that we'd done the hard work, because the two games against Real Madrid were tough. They really were. You know, we had to work very, very hard to get through it. Apart from the skill side of it, it was difficult.
Talk us through your goal in the first extra time goal, the decisive goal, really.
Well, Alex had cleared it upfield. It was route one, really. You know, it was amazing how it worked out, because we'd played some terrific stuff, but it was straight from Alex and it was flicked on. And the defender came in, and I still had a little bit of work to do, and I stuck it through his legs, and the keeper came out maybe a little bit too quick, but I'd already made my mind up I was going to go past him anyway, so I'd made my mind up before the game I was going to go past him if I got the chance, but I was going to head it in on the line, but he got up too quick, so I had to, and that was it, you know, we scored shortly afterwards. And got another one as a bonus. So the night was just, but just to score the first one, this kid from Belfast, you know, 7 years after going over there to play at Wembley in the European Cup final and scored a goal that virtually sealed it.
So you're only 22.
Yeah.
Okay. And you wanted to actually stop the ball and get down.
Yeah, that was my plan, yeah.
I like to see you try that against a team like Estudiantes.
No, you're not. You're going to end up the back of the net before the ball.
And then the 69 semi-final against Milan, that's seen as the sort of the end of that era of Manchester United. Is that true to say?
Yeah, I think so. We felt we should have won it that year as well, because the second game at Old Trafford, when we equalised, we scored a good goal. I mean, and no matter how often you see it, it wasn't just over the line, it was a good yard over. I mean, you freeze it, luckily the cameras could freeze, and it wasn't even close. I mean, and to see Sir Matt get annoyed about a decision, it was very rare. And I think if I'd have gone in, we might have won it again that year, which would have been nice. But I think, as I say, you know, Bill Foulkes was getting towards the end of his career. Bobby was getting towards the end. Dennis and Paddy. And, you know, we were losing half of a great side virtually overnight. But at least we managed to do it before they all moved on.
And when you won the European Footballer of the Year, how important was that in those days?
Well, it was massive. I mean, it's and the winner at my age, I mean, normally it's something you get when you're 30, 31, or late 30s, and getting towards the end. I won it right almost at the start.
So it's your title, though. Do you want that?
Or? No, yeah. I don't know.
Anyone in that position is definitely going to ring back. Anyway. So the European Player of the Year, talking about that, how important it was in... At that time,
late 60s. Well, I mean, all trophies are important, and all. I mean, I'm not one of those that thinks that you shouldn't go up and receive individual awards. I love it, and it was just a way of, you know, people saying, "Hey, you're the best around at the moment," and the winner at that age was just was unheard of for someone so young to win it. It's usually towards the end when you win European Players of the Year or British Players of the Year. I mean, Teddy Sheringham was British Player of the Year when he was 35. I did it when I was 22. So it was, I think if you're honoured in football in any way, shape or form, it's a compliment.
Mm. I mean, it was nice the way Teddy did it the other way around, you know.
Right, oh, yeah. Right, yeah. Right, yeah. Right. Well, some players are like that. He just... he's just got better and better, Teddy Sheringham. You know? I mean, he was always a terrific player. And the older he got, the better he got, whereas it's usually the opposite.
Yeah. You talking about Dennis Law, I mean, he was a super player. Were you not tempted to go to Italy as well?
Not really, I didn't want to play anywhere else. I didn't want to play in Italy, I didn't want to play in Spain. And I didn't want to play for any other club, basically. I could have gone to Chelsea. There was a lot of talk about Chelsea or abroad, but I didn't want to play for anyone except Man United, so I went off to America.
When you left Man United, there were some problems there, and you were banned by FIFA from playing anywhere. What were the circumstances behind that?
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. It was all down to registration. There's not many clubs saying that they owned me. A team in America, you had Fulham involved, you had Hibs, I suppose, and Man United. So it was all, it's very complicated. So typical FIFA, they took the easy way out and banned me from playing anywhere, which was a bit drastic to say the least.
And the NASL, I mean, did you go over there for the lifestyle or a bit of sunshine?
I went for everything. I wanted to get away from England. The league was starting, it was exciting. And all the best players in the world going there. The money was good, the lifestyle was great. And the crowds were terrific. It seemed a perfect opportunity to get away from it all and start afresh. And I went there and got really fit, trained hard, and enjoyed it. I was there for 7 years. Opened a nice little business there, a sports bar, which with a friend of mine who was also an ex-footballer, played for Man City. And we had the business for 14 years. Even after I left, it kept going for a long time. And it was a nice break, and I was living down on the beach in California, so it was terrific. It was a nice break.
Were you in LA?
Yeah, I went to New York first. I was going to sign for the Cosmos, but they wanted me to live in New York, and I didn't fancy that. I wanted to be in sunshine. Yeah. So and then they signed Pelé, of course. So they did the East against the West, and Pelé against me. That was their big selling point in those days.
And at its height, at its peak, the NASL was amazing. You know, they were outselling all the traditional American sports. Why do you think that it didn't work?
Well, it didn't work. It's quite simple, because they had all the best players playing there from day one, and then they replaced them with Americans. And you can't do that. I mean, we had the. When you think that you had Beckenbauer and Pelé and Cruyff and Gordon Banks and myself all playing over, Gerd Müller was there. And then you only had to play three Americans. Then it became four, then it was five, then it was six, then it was seven. And the Americans who had seen the best players in the world now were watching kids coming from college who couldn't play. And they wouldn't stand for it, so they stopped going. And it was quite simple. Yeah, They, for some strange reason, I thought the Americans had caught up pretty quickly. It's like trying to bring baseball here and saying within 5 or 6 years that the British are better at baseball than the Americans are. It just doesn't work that way.
And I guess you'd also have the same thing. I mean, the media in America never really seemed behind soccer.
No, well, it was always going to be difficult. And the only way you could have changed it was by keeping the best players. But coverage was non-existent. I mean, it's just you got a couple of lines if you were lucky, and the score, and that was about it. Because they'd been brought up, the kids had been brought up in American football, baseball, ice hockey, basketball. So football was a minority sport in a massive country, probably the most sports-minded country in the world. But football wasn't their game, so they were never going to take to it, the Americans.
Did they know who you were? Well, I mean, after the amount of attention that you received here?
No. Well, the Americans certainly didn't. The local, you know, expats did. You know, and maybe the Mexicans to a certain degree in Los Angeles. But our crowds were mostly expats, and the same in San Jose when I went there in Fort Lauderdale. They were all Brits who were living over there who came to the game. Few Americans, but the Americans had no idea who I was.
Mm. Why do you think there was that reluctance to accept soccer as part of the American culture?
It's just, well, they didn't understand it. You know, it's difficult. It's like, I mean, I don't understand baseball or basketball. I understand American football because I watched a lot of it and got to learn how it was, because I enjoyed the physical side of it. But the other sports, I couldn't tell you, you know, any of the rules. Well, I'll tell you some of them, but the Americans were the same. They didn't understand the offside law. They didn't understand most of the stuff that they were watching. I mean, the only time they made a noise was when it was a goal. And that was that's as much as they knew about football, most of them.
Mm-hmm. Still the top goal scorer for Manchester United, but only 9 goals in 27 games for Northern Ireland. Was there the debate between club and country that there is nowadays, that you see players, professional players, being faced with nowadays? Or was that just more of a case that Northern Ireland, unfortunately?
No, it was, unfortunately, if you're playing with a club who's successful, you're playing more games and you're involved in more European games, which is why people like Ryan Giggs haven't played a lot of times for the country, and I had the same, because if Northern Ireland were playing the Wednesday, we were probably playing in Europe on a Wednesday. And of course, Man United paid my wages, so they're the team I had to play for. It was quite simple. I mean, I'd like to have played 100 times for my country, but I couldn't change the circumstances, so there was no point in worrying about it.
Yeah. And do you think that problem's got worse now?
Well, certainly not for Northern Ireland, because there's not many players in the Northern Ireland squad whose teams are involved in Europe. Ryan Giggs is different because, you know, he's playing for Man United. They're always in Europe, so, and they're always in the cup games, and he's involved in probably, you know, or could be involved in 70 games a season. So there are going to be times when it's inevitable that he's going to have to miss a certain amount of games, more than they would want him to miss, and so I'm not sure more than he wants to miss, but that's the way it is.
I thinking about Ryan Giggs, I can remember when Ryan Giggs first came on the football scene, that there was what seemed at the time anyway, like a huge amount of media interest surrounding him. You know, he was a heartthrob, which then now compared to people like Beckham was just nothing. Now, is it true to say that you were the first person in Britain to create this kind of mass media interest?
Well, I certainly was the first one who got into the commercial side of it, because footballers had never been used, yet they just kicked the ball around. I started selling everything, you know, from aftershave to eggs to milks, oranges, chewing gum, you name it, and I was advertising it, clothes. And it was a decade of, you know, it was the swinging 60s, and I was part of it. Long hair was coming in because of the Beatles, the music was massive, fashion was changing, and football was, you know, the crowds were coming back. You know, 50,000-60,000 at games, you know, internationals. Even in Belfast, we were getting the full house at Windsor, no matter who we played. So I'd sort of gone to the showbiz side of it, which they'd never seen before, because it had always been cloth cap football, and all of a sudden it started to change, and I was in there at the ground floor, so to speak.
So you were there because of the way you looked. The link between the culture of pop music and the Beatles, the Stones, and football, is that the way it worked? I mean,
well, not really. They were all friends of mine. You know, the people in the music business. I had more friends probably in the theatre and music and films than I had in football. So it was all part and parcel. You know, and I used to go to rock concerts and watch them. They used to come to the games and watch us.
Did you feel that you were in the same business as that?
I was, yeah. Well, we were. I mean, it was quite simple. We entertained people who paid to come and watch us, and I was doing the same as my pals were doing. They were getting on stage, and I was getting on a stage, which is why Old Trafford's called it Theatre of Dreams now, because that's what it was. It was theatre.
And at the moment, I think people like, someone like, for instance, clacking an example out of the blue, someone like Michael Owen, He's very carefully protected, and he's trained about how to deal with all these things. Now, presumably, when you were there, you were just chapped out there.
Well, the difference is, in my day, there was no agents. There was no such thing as an agent in football. Now, of course, they've got secretaries and agents and accountants and bank managers and all sorts of people looking after them, apart from people who are involved with the club. We didn't have any of that when I was playing. I mean, my first agent was from Huddersfield. He also handled Dennis's affairs, Ken Stanley. I mean, it wasn't quite the high-powered tech agents of today.
Yeah, I've got a quote here that Ken Stanley said that you could put George's name on steroids and sell them to bungalows. Well, what is it about footballers that advertisers like so much, do you think?
Well, because they're in the public eye all the time. It's quite simple. And it just seems common sense that people will want to use footballers or any athletes, because everyone knows who they are. They're easily recognisable. And so it's just putting two and two together, and that's why they sell. I mean, you stick Michael Owen's name in anything, or David Beckham's today, and they'll sell it, because everyone knows who they are.
Did you personally find it very difficult to lead such a public life, in your mid-20s, suddenly be known as El Beatle in Spain?
It didn't bother me in those days. It was a compliment, people knocking on your door, giving you lots of money for advertising stuff. And really, the work wasn't too difficult. Be more, I suppose, if they had been knocking on the door, but they were. I was earning more off the pitch than I was on it. I mean, massive amounts of money for those days. So it was for a kid from Belfast who'd never been away from home before. People calling up and offering me fortunes for a day's work was good fun.
So you just enjoyed it? I mean, it sounds like you enjoyed it reading.
Well, it was, because at the end of the day, I went home and got ready for training the next day or for the match the next day, and that was my lifestyle. It wasn't a bad lifestyle to be living and enjoying it. I was getting paid to advertise stuff and getting paid to keep fit and playing in front of 55,000 people every week.
Yeah.
So I didn't have many complaints.
You advertised bras once, didn't you?
I didn't advertise them, but they used my name. Yeah, I didn't wear them. Yeah, I did an ad for Playtex once, yeah.
Well, what did you have to do?
Nothing. I was sitting at a bar and asked a girl if she wanted a drink, and she said no. And their slogan was that if she can turn me down, it's because she's wearing a Playtex bra. So that was just
I suppose the peak of your celebrity. As we said, I mean, it's been quite a localised affair, but there's been a complete love affair between the press and you. A lot of it because you supply these brilliant stories, which I'm not actually sure how true they are. Like it's a legendary story about you in a casino, and you just won lots of money, and you were with a girlfriend who was not wearing very much, and the bellboy arrived with some champagne. Could you tell us that story?
No.
No.
It's not true anyway. So
is it not
point
true?
In telling it, no.
And he said, where did it all go wrong?
No, it's a story I use in my after-dinner speeches.
Okay. So we shouldn't believe everything that we read about?
You shouldn't believe anything. I give them what they want to hear.
I mean, how much of you said about the very positive side, like, you were getting paid good money to do fairly easy work, which in a way just made you better known, which meant that the next time you could charge even more money. So that's the positive side. I mean, how much of a nuisance has the press been to you?
Well, they're still a nuisance. Because they print stuff, like you've just mentioned, is not true. I mean, and they get away with it. They can make anything up, say anything they want about anybody. And they did it more to me than anybody, because it was easy fodder for them, I suppose. And they still do it. And they still follow me around. They still, since I stopped drinking, they follow me hoping I'm going to fall down and get a photograph of me being picked up out of the gutter, but I'm a long way. I use them. I mean, it's the only way to beat them. They, you know, if they think they're being clever, they're the ones who pay me. I don't have to pay them to take my photograph.
They once announced that you were dead. That was just last year, was it the year before?
Yeah, for the second time.
And how do you feel?
Well, I think it's funny, but my family don't. When you get a phone call from someone telling you that your son's dead, it's not been nice for my dad. But that about sums them up for me. You know, you think they'd check before they actually put it out or call anyone. It's not too difficult to get a hold of me and ask me if I'm dead or not.
I was going to say, I mean, it must be fairly easy to repute, at least. No, I'm not.
Yeah.
Is that, I mean, the fact that you've had your ups and downs, I mean, you once said we've got an archive interview of you, and you said that something along the lines of you yourself were responsible for everything that's, you had yourself to blame for everything. Do you still think that that's true?
Yeah, I mean, you can't blame anybody else. Yeah, I mean, you're the one at the end of the day who makes the final decision. You can ask advice and people can tell you, but at the end of the day, I've got to decide what I'm going to do, how I'm going to do it. So, I mean, that's one thing I've never done. I've never blamed anyone else for any mistakes I've made.
Yeah. Do you think at the moment that there's too much football on the television? Do you think that we're running a risk of actually reaching some kind of saturation point where the popularity is just going to turn the corner?
I think there's a lot of bad football on. I think the Premiership is the best it's ever been. I think the coverage is the best it's ever been. And I mean, I work in the media, so I get paid to watch something I still love. We have all the best players in the world coming to New England to play, or most of the best players. So it's just, for me, it's just, I think once you get outside the Premiership, then you're talking about too much actual, well, I personally think it's, you know, I can't watch it because I find it so poor. But the Premiership is certainly a little bit special.
Mm. I mean, is there a risk of the divide getting too big between?
Well, it's already big, the divide's already there. Not only between the Premiership and the bottom of the league, but the Premiership top and bottom. I mean, the bottom side of the Premiership, the gap between them and the winners now is massive.
And do you think the links between football clubs and television, like Man United TV, is that natural that this is going to happen more and more as time goes on?
Yeah, that's inevitable. Yeah, because it's big business. You know, they're both involved in making money or trying to. So if you can combine the two and stick the resources together and make it better overall, it's inevitable and it's happened.
If one of the episodes we're doing is called The Media, if you had a message for the media, what would that be? Stop calling you up.
Bestie.
Yeah, so just to repeat the question, if you had a message for the media, what would that be?
Unfortunately, you can't tell the media what to do, but I'd just like to print the truth a bit more often and get their facts right. But, you know, unfortunately, they can't get away with it because there's not many people can fight them. I mean, you're talking about if you decide to go against them, they'll always find a way back. And I said earlier, I'd fight them my way, you know, I use them. And if they're still going to write nasty stuff about you, so you might as well try and get something out of it. And that's the way I handle it. But some people can't handle it. I mean, my family find it difficult to handle. My wife finds it difficult to handle. But I just wish that sometimes I'd sit back and look at the overall picture instead of wondering how many copies they can sell. And that's business again, I suppose, from their point of view. It's not the business I would want to be in, but they're the ones that are in it.
I mean, your fame's lasted all this time. You're still selling newspapers. And how much of that has been your personality, and how much of that has been your skill? I mean, had you not been a special football player because of the way you looked? I mean, you once said that, again, I don't know what you said and what you haven't said. I read that you said that if you had been ugly, no one would have heard of Pelé.
No, what I said was I would have found it more easy to deal with things if they hadn't been chasing me for photographs every day, which they interpreted it to be that I was better looking than Pelé or whatever they put it. I don't know, I think the bottom line is that people still talk about me because I was good at what I did. And if one person thinks I was the best at what I did, that's good enough for me. And my dad thinks I was. So that's
and how much of that was, again, coming back to all the people that we've spoken to making this series, all of the top players, be interesting to hear. How much do you think of your talent was inborn, natural talent, and how much of that did you develop at Man United?
Well, I believe I was born with a gift, but I also worked very, very hard at it to improve on something I already had. I think it's got to be there to start with, and it certainly was with me. I didn't have to work to be better than all the other kids at school at football, but the areas that I had to work on, I did, and I worked harder than anyone else to make them better. So I think if you've got that combination, that sooner or later you'll end up at the top.
Okay, two final things. Who do you think was the best player ever?
Di Stéfano was the best player I ever saw.
And why was that?
Because he could do everything. He was brilliant. He could score goals. He had 2 feet. He was good in the air. He worked hard. He tackled. And he played in a great side. So if you stand out in a great side, you're a little bit special.
Finally, we've asked people for their definition of football, what football means to them. What does football mean to you? What does it represent to you?
Well, apart from, there was one thing that I wouldn't want taken away from me, apart from my family, it would be football. That's how much it meant and still does. I just love it. I love the whole idea of great athletes and theatre and floodlights and thousands of people turning up to watch you play. It's special.
Thank you very much. Cheers. Thanks for the time.